Okay, so we have seen how first order differential equations, when they are separable, can be solved formally, you know, by collecting terms in a nice way and just integrating. Now, in this lecture, we will see how if first order ODE, if it happens to be linear, there is a nice prescription that we can give for a general problem of this kind. Linear first order differential equations can be solved exactly as will be described in this lecture. Okay, so the most general form for a linear first order ODE is dy by dx plus some function of x, we'll call it p of x times y is equal to another function of x, which is q of x, right? So this is as general as it gets. So we have seen that if q of x is equal to 0, then this differential equation is also a homogeneous differential equation. And on the other hand, if q of x is present, which is also sometimes called the driving term, right? So then it becomes an inhomogeneous differential equation. So in general, so when you're interested in solving an inhomogeneous differential equation, we should first solve the corresponding homogeneous equation and then see what happens if you also have a driving term. So in the spirit of this philosophy, so let's first look at the solution for the problem dy by dx plus p of x y is equal to 0. So this turns out to be a separable differential equation. So you can bring it to this form, dy by dx is equal to minus p of x times y, and then you bring y to the left hand side and then dx to the right hand side, and then you have a formal solution. Y is equal to a times e to the minus integral p of x dx, right? Straightforward. Now we will look at this quantity called I. We will define I is equal to integral p of x dx. It turns out that this quantity is useful even when you have the more general problem, which involves a forcing term, right? If the forcing term is non-zero, you can still, consider this quantity I. Let's define I is equal to integral p of x dx. Therefore, the derivative of this quantity is p of x, right? So this is just by definition. If the integral of p of x dx is I, di by dx must be equal to p of x. So we have the solution for this problem is y is equal to a times e to the minus I, right? So, or in other words, y times e to the I is a constant, right? If the right hand side did not have a forcing term. But let's look at this quantity y times e to the I and take the derivative. So think of this quantity, right? It's a completely legitimate quantity to study, and let's see what its dependence is if you plug back in the forcing term, right? So now suppose q of x is non-zero, but you can still consider y times e to the I and take its derivative with respect to x. So if you take the derivative of this quantity with respect to x, right? So we have this rule of for differentiation of product of two functions. So we have dy by dx times e to the I, which is treated like a constant, plus y times the derivative of e to the I, which is nothing but e to the I times di by dx. Now, because it's this exponential, you can pull this out, you get the same factor in both the terms, you pull this out, and then you have dy by dx plus p of x times y inside brackets, right? But if you look at this quantity carefully, right? So this we will see is actually nothing but this quantity, the left hand side of the original. So this is nothing but the left hand side of the original differential equation, right? Which would be zero if the forcing term is zero. And indeed, it's not a surprise, because if y times e to the I is equal to a constant, the derivative has to be zero. But here, in the more general case, it's not going to be zero, but we will replace the stuff inside these brackets with just q of x. So we have d by dx of y times e to the I is equal to q of x times e to the I. So now what we have is, on the left hand side we have an exact derivative of some function, and on the right hand side we have a function of x alone. So we can integrate both sides. The left hand side is easy to integrate because we have already given the derivative of some function. So it's y times e to the I is equal to integral of a function which is purely a function of x on the right hand side. So you get integral of q of x e to the I dx plus some constant, right? And so we are left with, now we can bring back this e to the I to the, you know, multiply throughout with e to the minus I. So then you are just left with y is equal to e to the minus I integral q of x e to the I dx plus c times e to the minus I, where I is also given, you know, which we define as integral p of x dx. So in fact, this box is the prescription. This is the general solution for a first order linear differential equation, ordinary differential equation, right? So you just find this I, you know, multiply throughout with e to the I, and then you identify this left hand side to be an exact derivative, and then just integrate and you're done, right? So let's look at, you know, how this operates in practice. So let's solve this differential equation, 1 plus x squared dy by dx plus 4xy is equal to x. So I am given this differential equation. So the first step is to bring it to this canonical form, right? We have worked out this theory in a particular form, so we have to bring this differential equation into that form. So in order to do that, okay, so we are also given this initial condition. So this, there is always a free constant associated with a first order linear differential equation, and that free constant is fixed if you are giving, if you are given also an initial condition, right? Y of x equal to 0 equal to 1 is given in this case. Okay, so to bring it to the standard form, we just divide throughout by 1 over, divide throughout by 1 plus x squared. So we have dy by dx plus 4x divided by 1 plus x squared y is equal to x over 1 plus x squared, right? So p of x is equal to 4x divided by 1 plus x squared. So immediately we identify that this is connected to the form that we, you know, the general form that we worked with. And so p of x here corresponds to 4x divided by 1 plus x squared, and q of x here corresponds to x over 1 plus x squared, right? So although we could just directly sort of use this prescription as it is and, you know, keep all this stuff in our head, it's more transparent to just, you know, compute I and multiply throughout by e to the I. So I is equal to integral dx 4x divided by 1 plus x squared, and this we immediately see is nothing but, you know, log of 1 plus x squared times 2. If I take a derivative of this, I get 1 over 1 plus x squared, then 2x multiplied by 2 will give me 4x. So this is integral of this, right? So you might ask, you know, there should be a free constant available, but that's not a problem because this is just the sort of intermediate step, and we will anyway get this free constant at the end. So as far as this, you know, when you're finding I, you can choose whatever constant you want and you can take it to be zero, right? And there's no loss of generality. And e to the I is 1 plus x squared the whole squared, right? So this is follows directly from, you know, this what I is. Multiplying throughout with e to the I, we have 1 plus x squared the whole squared times dy by dx plus one of these 1 plus x squareds, you know, in the denominator will cancel. So then you have plus 4x times 1 plus x squared times y is equal to x times 1 plus x squared, right? So now a little, you know, a careful look at this differential equation in this form immediately tells us that in fact the left hand side can be written as an exact derivative, right? So this is not a surprise because that's the whole point of this e to the I, you're multiplying throughout to bring it into this special form. So d by dx of 1 plus x squared the whole squared times y, you can check this, if you take a derivative you will get this, you know, 2 into 2 4x times 1 plus x squared times y, that's the second term, and the first term is, you know, you treat 1 plus x squared the whole squared as it is and take a derivative with respect to dy by dx. And the right hand side, it's convenient to expand it out and write it as x plus x cube. Integrating both sides, we have, you know, the left hand side is super easy, it's just 1 plus x squared the whole squared times y. Right hand side will give you x squared by 2 plus x to the 4 by 4 plus this constant, right? So you do get this free constant in the end in any case. So that's the reason why when you're finding I, you can afford to be, you know, sloppy about not including any. See, and it's not even being sloppy, because in the end we are anyway taking care of this. There's only one free constant you will get in the final answer. So the initial condition in fact removes that free constant as well. So in this case we get the free constant, the initial condition will force C to be 1, because you have to have, when you put x equal to 0, you know, the left hand side y must be equal to 1, so C is equal to 1. So if you plug this in, you see that the final complete solution for this problem with the given initial condition is x to the 4 plus 2x squared plus 4 divided by 4 into 1 plus x squared the whole squared, right? So already we have a fairly powerful tool, so you can play with, you know, differential equations of this kind. You can come up with your own variants of this, you know, come up with p of x's and q of x's, and see how, you know, this whole method plays out, right? So this is like a prescription which is solidified by working out many example problems, right? So in this lecture we have discussed how to solve an ordinary differential equation which is linear and of first order. That's all for this lecture. Thank you.